That's great, thank you. I think there's a lot of commonality in what people are looking to get out of the day. We've designed today to be suitable for everyone, so we hope we meet your requirements. Obviously, if there's one particular element that you are looking at and you want to talk about that further, we can do that during the breakout sessions, or obviously set up a following call with either one of ourselves or Rob or Simon. So thank you everyone for that.
Just a point as well, a lot of people have made a point about new functionality and maybe how you're using it, how you can stretch that. And part of the reason, I'm Michael Badley, I'm one of the account management team, so one of the real things that my existing accounts would benefit from is this configuration review which we put in your bike, because often how it's originally set up is the organisation changes and maybe you're only using a fraction of what is available. And we're going to share with you some of the updates since the last user group, and there's loads of really exciting things, so often it's just about stretching your experience, and that's what we're trying to provide for you in the device. So that's like a little gift, I suppose.
Okay, so we just wanted to take a look at last year and have a look at a couple of numbers. The last year has been very, very interesting and exciting, not just for Qualsys or product EQMS, but we feel for the whole industry. And we were at the CQI conference yesterday, and it was really interesting to hear how everybody within quality is looking at certain aspects of using data and being able to report and having a real impact within their organisation. So we feel the quality industry as a whole is a really exciting place to be working and operating for us currently. So we've just got some numbers up there, some are a little bit more personal to Qualsys, some are more general. The first one I bring out is 20 years old. So we celebrated our 20th anniversary last month. We're very proud of the age and the fact that we've been operating within the GRC and quality industry for 20 years. There's not many other software organisations who can say that, so it's something we're very proud of. And it's over those 20 years that we've evolved EQMS into about 9 different modules and operating in over 100 countries day to day. The next one is number 8, which is new faces. During the last year, we added 8 new faces to the Qualsys team, and that was spread right across lots of different departments within the company, from our own team, the sales and marketing, to the implementation team, the development team, the testing team, and the administration one. So all across Qualsys, we've been adding new talent to the organisation to match the growth that we're seeing in the demand in the product. 2,500 is a figure that represents the new users that we brought on in the business in the last year. 2,500 new users. So that's new users of EQMS on a daily basis. Now, obviously, that's great for us as a business, but also for the user group community. That's good that we've got even more people who use EQMS day to day, think about how they'd like to use it going forward, any suggestions they have on making changes. And it also reflects the collaborative way that we like to work on improving the product. So hopefully all of the people in the room who are existing clients will have experience that we listen to your ideas and your feedback on the product and then try and improve it going forward. And 34.4% is our NPS, our Net Promoter Score. And it was interesting yesterday, a couple of the companies presenting at CQI also benchmarked their company on an NPS. Those of you who don't know, Net Promoter Score is a gauge of customer loyalty. And they do a survey, and anybody who responds with a 9 to 10 is seen as a positive response. Anybody 1 to 6 is actually seen as a negative, and 7 made to neutral and discarded from the calculation. So we're very strong at 34.4, and it's actually up there with, let me get this right, Sony Computers and Samsung TV. So we're punching with some big names up there. So we're very proud of that score, and it's been one that's been very consistent for Qualsys over the last 4 or 5 years since we've been tracking it, but it is on an upward curve as well. Number 6, runners. Last week we took part in the Sheffield Half Marathon, some of you are aware of that already, and that represents about 25% of our workforce, or 20% of our workforce, so we're very proud that we did that. When I was putting this slide together, I wasn't aware of where we came in our team results. But we had a very good average time, so I thought I'd pop that one up for you as well. 11 is the number of countries that our 4 p.m. pint was Drunken and Enjoyed in November. So we put that campaign together. Again, Callum at the back of the room, I think, can take a slight bow for the credit there. So we put that campaign together to try and celebrate World Quality Day. We did feel it was a little bit risky to do something with a beer, but we felt it reflected the nature of the business that we're in, and we really wanted people to reflect on the good work that they've done in the year and World Quality Day, and we felt what better way to do it than have a pint at the end of a working day. Obviously there's a World Quality Day 2015 coming up, so if any of you have any suggestions about what we can do to celebrate it this year, Callum's your man, let him know what you think. 173 is the number of line items that went into version 6.5 of EQMS, so the next version, the latest upgrade that myself and Rob will be looking at shortly with you. When you log an issue or an idea or a comment with Qualsys, it's hopefully resolved in a manner that's satisfactory to you, but it's not then forgotten about either, and it goes through an internal process that means that we then reflect on it and consider whether or not it should be put forward for the next build of EQMS. So every time somebody logs something within Qualsys, there's a lot going on behind the scenes that as customers you're not aware of. Now the latest version of EQMS contains a lot of updates, and it's just that there's 173 line items that have come out of that process. There's obviously other external influences on that as well. But we felt it was a good reflection to let you know we're listening to you, we're hearing the comments that you make about the product, so please keep them coming over the relationship. Number 24 is the number of attendees that we had confirmed for today. This is the first time we've held the user group outside of Sheffield. So again, it was a little bit of a gamble, but we wanted to try doing it in London after the CQI conference and maybe attract some of the users who struggled to get to one in Sheffield. We're aware it's very nice weather at the moment, we'd have a few dropouts, but it's fantastic to see so many of you here today. And again, we appreciate you making the time. Then just two more. 21% is the number of companies, according to an LNS survey recently, who've got a deployed enterprise quality management software system. Sorry. So only 21%. Okay. In that survey, they found that 40% have thought about it, of which 7% have also got a budget. But anybody can do the maths there and realise that you people in the room are a little bit ahead of some of your competition. And so I think you should give yourself a pat on the back for already being there and having something deployed within your company, and hopefully you're seeing the benefits of that. Yesterday at the CQI conference, they were looking at the cost of product recall and whether or not a properly deployed quality management system could stop the issues happening and the costs that then are incurred by the business. And they were looking at the automotive industry, where they said that Toyota last year recalled 1.7 million cars, and also GM have its cost of General Motors 1.7 billion, and the cost of recalls due to a faulty ignition switch. That also includes 13 deaths due to that ignition switch. So those of you who've got a quality management system deployed within your company, that would hopefully be negating the chance of anything like that happening in having a product recall. Okay, finally, 53.43, that was the percentage of respondents to our global quality survey who responded that they felt overworked in some capacity within their role. So some of those people might be here today, and we're aware as a company who develops software that our software needs to bring efficiency into your working place to make sure that we help that figure go down over time. So one of the things that we're always aware of when we're looking at future versions of EQMS is how can we do that? How can we make it easier for you to interact with the software, but how can we make sure that that's bringing the efficiency to you? Okay, so that's just a quick review of last year. That last stat came out of our global quality survey, and I'm now going to hand over to Michael, who will take you through that survey and the results in greater detail.
That's as if we'd planned it.
Can I ask a quick question? Everyone at a comfortable temperature, or would you like to be there? Everyone's fine with them. Was it okay, or it's very warm?
It's warm.
I'm just getting angry with it.
Thank you, Ben. And it's really interesting, some of the feedback we were talking regarding the CQI conference yesterday, actually. I was speaking to Rob Gibson a second ago about one of the challenges we face in quality is sometimes speaking in a sort of common business language and communicating the sort of return on investment or the impact of the work that we do to operational departments or managements. And often it's easier to sort of understand when you're talking about the cost of product recalls or the savings we've made from sort of lowering the non-conformances rather than some of the smaller initiatives. And I think that disconnect is something which hopefully one of our feelings is with the dashboard and some of the functions we're looking at, how can we give you more relevant business information at hand which you can win that kind of hearts and mind battle. So that was interesting feedback there. In terms of what I'm going to do, is I'm going to give you about 30 minutes overview of the Global Quality Survey. About in January or February, you may have seen the email come through and you might have even participated in the survey yourself. And if you did, then thank you very much, because it was about a 20-minute, 25-minute exercise, quite a qualitative exercise to try and take the temperature of how you guys operate, how our customers operate, and some of the challenges that are faced in the sector. And I suppose I'm in a very unique position. Qualsys is a very privileged position because we have customers in, I could say, using it around the world. Almost 203 countries are using the EQMS in different sectors. My personal accounts are in outsourcing, in manufacturing, in healthcare, in various different sectors. And although, it's nice and cool where I am at the moment. Although they're very different regulatory environments, actually there's lots of common ground between the challenges that we face in our roles. Obviously some of the detail is different. And working in your own sectors, and part of the reason we brought this group together today in the user group and not had a healthcare specific one and a sector specific like we might have done in the past, is that there's sometimes a chance for you guys to come and sort of learn from each other, for us to learn and sort of contrast your experiences as well. So the global survey was our chance to do that as well. And what I wanted to do is talk through some of the introductions and some of the information we got out of this. Again, this will be shared afterwards and then we're doing lots of the work, so this is hot off the press for you. So I'm going to sort of skip through lots of data, but in terms of the structure, I'm not sure in this room if anybody actually completed the survey or seen it before. So thank you guys, a few of you. Talk about yourself, about you and the person. We talk about your role, we talk about the organisation, and we ask those kinds of questions. And then some of the lessons learned in the past 12 months, and then we look forward to the next 5 years. And again, as Ben talked about, we're constantly evolving the product and the solution which we deliver for you, and the roadmap which we're going to talk about next, which again is seamless. And helps us sort of visualise the challenges that people have. Annex SL and the change in ISO 9001 standard was more impact on internal auditing. In senior management, you can't just go golfing when you're going to get inspected anymore and leave it to the quality team. There's actually got to be senior management buy-in, and there's got to be a real impact there. So how can we do that? And we understood this a few years ago, and that's why we put lots and lots of resource. I think we spend 7 figures a year on the product, lots of resource into improving the auditing capability, into improving the dashboard. So that's an example of previously. So I'm really intrigued by this kind of results. And at the breaks, we'd really like to get your feedback and try and sanity check some of the information coming out of it and see if it feels comfortable and familiar to your experiences in the role. So just to give you a slide or two about the kind of respondents, quite senior roles. I think 27% were quality managers, which is probably representative of our audience as much as anything else. So people who were heavily engaged in the profession. And again, quite loyal people here, people who are really invested in their own businesses. I think nearly all of the people have been with the company for 2+ years. So again, it gives sort of weight to the kind of responses that we received. And again, I think it's the nature of us all, we're very professionally engaged. I think something like 24% were CQI members, then this ERCO was second, and then ASQ. But there's many other different memberships and certifications that people participated in. And again, I think that's just because of the nature of the role. It's a And like I'm in a privileged position, most people in your role, you can see everything. You've got access to all parts of the business, and you've got a very, like the cat's whiskers really, you've got a very important role to play, and that's probably why people are so heavily engaged in learning. This is probably a good start for people like Alex in the room, the certification manager for ERCA. Most people spend plus 15 hours a year on CPD events like this one. Does that feel familiar to you, or do you think you spend more than 15 hours a year? Because that's the amount you need to maintain your certification with ERCA, isn't it, as well? So again, the audience was there. And we asked questions for our own benefit. Part of our role, you might have noticed it from Qualsys, but we are heavily investing in providing valuable content and educational resources to our audience. So you might have seen the ISO 9001 toolkit, you might have seen in your bikes, there's a white paper about auditing we did with ERCA, and we've got a whole suite of educational content and materials because it's in our interest to enable our users to be better in their jobs and to demonstrate their own value, and it's in our interest to make them more effective with the product. So that was really useful. And the middle one there, internet resources, was the most preferred access because it's convenient, I imagine. So that's the reason we're recording this session, so we can have a little microsite and allow people to go access to this and share it with their teams and learn some of the sessions. But also workshops and sort of industry magazines, Quality World magazine was the most read, and then things like LinkedIn are actually rising from the responses as well, so the groups and forums on LinkedIn. But again, been picking your brains at lunchtime to see how we can provide the right kind of content to you guys to help you in your job role. We're going to probably do more events like this, and we're going to break that down into more topical, technical, tutor-led events and technical issues, so that's going to be interesting to share that with you as well. So challenges. Often there's three C's there about culture and communication and managing change, which is up for every organisation. And how can we address those things? So I've just taken some quotes about the direct responses here. It's quite a weighty survey, but some of the challenges around managing the transition to ISO 9001-2015 and some of the other standards there. The rise of, I think it was always important, but sort of the more pronounced impacts of risk-based thinking. And in the CQI conference yesterday, it was very interesting that people view risk management as a negative thing. We're actually, it's opportunity and risks are the same spectrum, they're all part of the same story. So we're thinking about things like changing risk manager in EQMS to risks and opportunities, and just along with the communication so people see it and they can suggest things in a more proactive way, so it's not all about negative things. Again, supplier development and supplier management is a really important thing. The whole supply, like the horse meat scandal and all those big issues that have been over the last few years, mean that traceability is very important. So we saw that, and I think Rob's going to talk about supplier development. I'm not sure if that's the case, I think so. In some of the features and functionality we're putting together for EQMS. And again, quality first feels like a sensible kind of statement, but in operations we've read a lot of feedback saying the ops people just want to get the job done, but the quality thing is a parallel, it's not part of the business. And actually there's a lot of talk about EQMS is that should really be EBMS because it's a business management system, not a quality management system, and that would sort of break that cycle, and that's some of the feedback we saw in the survey. This is really interesting. I think Richard Green's going to talk about it later. The lead auditors, it's a communication and a management role, and particularly with the changes to the standards where actually there's going to be more importance, even more importance on lots more internal auditing, because it is the way in which senior management will find out that kind of information. But you have to be quite tactful and learn new kind of skills to try and not ruffle people the wrong way while you're grilling them, basically. And there's a lot of that kind of feedback which we saw. And here, as Ben said, the whole workload and time and resources thing is always coming up again. It seems to be that we're always getting more work, but the departments are getting smaller in size. Although, I think yesterday at the CQI conference, there was an interesting point made that every time a problem happened on the manufacturing situation, they just put a new inspection in. And often it's the process which is wrong. They don't need to just create loads more inspections for the sake of it. I think in terms of policies and managing documentation, with the new standards, you can actually reduce most of your written policies and procedures down. And people were talking yesterday from 225 to 23. This is a large multinational company of 23 processes, because a lot of it can be done in flow charts and process maps. And that might help with this whole workload story as well, because maybe it's about working slightly differently, and that the changes to the standards give us that opportunity. So again, this is just bringing it out to what Ben said about feeling overworked as well, and I'm flying through some of these things because you can have the slides. This is the one which we're really curious about. Just over eight days a month spent compiling or working on reports. Does that feel right? I know some of my NHS departments, people like lost in spreadsheets 2 days a week. I don't know this room, but I know some of the other ones. But I'll have a silent nod of the head if it feels right, but for us it feels like a lot of time to spend in compiling reports. And obviously our job is to try and reduce that down, but that was very expensive, and intelligent people lost in spreadsheets feels like a waste of resource to me. And again, we asked this, and this is a question we knew the answer to, but and we're a software company, so we're biased towards this one, but the importance of using the right technology to do the job and not just sort of shared drives or out-of-date documentation. So in terms of the organisations who responded, again, it was a broad mix, and I just wanted to show it was representative here. We had primarily manufacturing, 56%, and then a whole spread of different ones over there. And again, the org sizes were, as you might expect, pretty traditional, lots of smaller ones, some larger organisations. So for us, it just gives a bit more validity to the data we were receiving from this one. And some of the trends which you might want to talk about here might be useful in your arguments and discussions back at base, really. Popular, let's use this word carefully, that just means that most, not most happy in terms of working with ISO 9001, but in terms of the most instance of response, which is pretty representative really, it's a very popular standard. But the interesting one, this is probably the most interesting one we've found, is what are people doing now, which is ISO 9001, the rise of environmental, sort of health and safety, but the future, a massive rise in health and safety, but also security and risk management as well. So one of the big trends that we're seeing is in people managing multiple standards. I don't know if that's familiar with you guys in the room, but it's not as difficult as it was in the past to just look after, say, ISO 9001. People are running two and three and four within one team. How do you do that when you've got 53% of your overworked? So if there's a demand for more standards from industry, Annex SL, which Rich is going to talk about later, makes it easier to have more standards in one system because you don't have to reinvent the wheel. But it's just, maybe it's in 3 to 4 years it might be accepted and almost the standard business practice to have three times more work than you've got now, I don't know. That's an interesting one anyway. And our respondents, which bearing in mind we're talking to quality professionals, not just the LMS one that Ben talked to, we had a slightly more respondents using a quality management electronic system. But for me, again, 56% don't. It's still just in paper or spreadsheets. So you are ahead of the curve, but God knows how they do their job. They must just be swamped and sort of never have a holiday or see the dog. So again, feedback from the last year and what we learned, and we want to validate this information, we want to really pick your brains on the lunch break, but that was quite a scary one. 20% almost felt that their company training towards the standards and quality is not effective at all. And maybe that's down to this discussion about, do management see the value? Are we communicating the benefits? If the have a load of non-conformances which cost £50,000 a year and you remove that, that's paid for the training, but are we speaking in a business language that people can buy into, or are we talking about Six Sigma and Lean and stuff which people are abstract and really, unless you're really interested, you just don't care so much about. So that was a really interesting point there. And there's some other ones here which you don't need to read that, if you get a gold star if you can, that's just for me. But essentially 38% of people are feeling unprepared for the changes to ISO, and a lot of people felt only slightly effective for risk management as well. So some interesting trends, and this is hot off the press. We'll be formalising this in white papers and making it available for you as well, so don't expect you to remember all these things. But the shape of this one's interesting because it says that the organisation has grown, but the size of the department has shrunken. So I feel sorry for you if you've got more work to do with less people. And this is the last section really. This is looking to the future, and this is really what we're here today to talk about. It's about what can we provide for you, what challenges are you guys facing, and how can we help you solve those in your role. And it's why we've got a technical director, we've got a training team here. We just want to use these. We've got, after lunch on your agenda, you'll notice there's a breakout session. And what we're going to do is go into two separate rooms with a whiteboard and just ask you to give us feedback about things you'd like to see, feature suggestions, challenges you face, and that can be product or service. And then we'll obviously publish those in the wrap-up to the user group, but also commit to sort of working through those in the way that Ben described with the 173 we went through in the last 12 months, which made it into the product. So quite an important point. But that is important, which I'm sure people like ERCO or training providers will be pleased to see, is that most people feel like there's a training need to help people with transitioning to the new standards, and maybe helping the non-internal champions. So you guys are quite new to, or you're looking for EQMS EME at the moment. So you're here today, which is great that you can. But a lot of organisations maybe don't have the resources, or maybe don't give time for people to be properly trained on these kinds of things, and that impacts their ability to get the value out of it. Culture of compliance was by far the biggest opportunity. How can we win the hearts and minds with that? But it's here about managing processes. That's the biggest opportunity for next year. Convincing senior management and giving the right tools to really justify the value that we provide. And these are the last couple of slides about the future, which for us are what we're going to really look ahead and try and work on and hang our hats on, so we'd like to validate those for you. That interchangeability there, that the idea that it's a business management system, it's integrated with SAP, it's integrated with HR systems, it's part of the fabric of how we do business. That Net Promoter Score, what Ben talked about, that is a simple example of how you can demonstrate and the impact of quality, because if you're making happier customers and there's less errors and you're feeding the improvements into the product, then the Net Promoter Score will increase. And it's a very simple communication, and ABB used that yesterday, a big massive organisation, they used that through the business as a simple KPI measurement of, are we doing a good job, are our customers getting more happy? And that's something what sales teams and MDs and finance people can understand. So for us, there's lots of exciting functionality to try and give you reports and outputs that you can communicate that effectiveness. Multiple standard stories, something which was 75%. The supply chain stuff, and maybe looking at portals and giving your suppliers access to restricted parts of EQMS so they can participate and do pre-assessments or things like that. There are some ideas that we've got as well. Managing risk. I mean, 80% of people were scared stiff of social media, and you can understand why, because you build a business and then something bad happens and it's all over the internet and you're screwed, basically. So the whole data integrity and managing processes to mitigate that risk is an important facet of what people were talking about. And something here which is about the dashboards and about the increase in mobile. I know we're seeing a lot of interest in iPads and the future in iPhones and Android, etc., and Windows. We're also seeing some organisations say my IT department won't sanction it. But I have to say, being out talking to people every day, if you asked me this a year ago, I bet that would have been 20%. So next year it might be 70%. So the trend is going in that direction, and you can see why. I think if you look to the agenda, I think we've got about half an hour in the afternoon to show you some of the mobile stuff as well, so you can go back to the office and get a free iPad from your bosses. So that's enough. There's lots of data in there, but that's just trying to show you the kind of externally and the sort of macro stuff that we're dealing with, and trying to listen to our audience. And as Ben said, we've got lots more users this year, and you'll notice a real big impact on how we design our training, how we design our products, and how we enable your teams to be more effective in supporting you in that role. But it starts with days like today, and you giving us that feedback in the session after lunch.